Punch Audio through the Audiobook Creation Exchange presents After. The Battle Has Just Begun. Written by R.J. Belle.
Out of every 100 men, 10 shouldn't even be there. 80 are just targets. 9 are the real fighters. And we are lucky to have them, for they make the battle. Ah, but the one is a warrior, and he will bring the others back. Heraclitus.
Chapter 1, Final Flight, by Stuart Witt. February 17, 2007, 0350, curbside at 24th and M, Washington, D.C., 16 degrees with a light breeze. Going home after my second week of freezing temps. Fly my aircraft, ride a horse, climb a mountain, and get back to living. I'm tired of the cold. 0425, paying the taxi fare at Dulles in front of the United Airlines counter, still cold. 0450, engaging the self-serve ticket machine, and it delivers my ticket, baggage tag, and boarding pass. That Marine is all dressed up early. Good morning, Captain. You're looking sharp. Pass security into my gate for a quick decaf coffee and 5 hours sleep. A quick check of the flight status monitor and UA flight 211 is on time. I'm up front. How bad can it be? That same Marine. He must be headed to Pendleton to see his lady at LAX for the long weekend all dressed up like that. Or maybe not. Attention in the boarding area. We will begin boarding in 10 minutes. We have some additional duties to attend to this morning, but we will have you out of here on time. That captain now has 5 others with him. Bingo, I get it. He is not visiting his lady. He's an official escort. How I remember doing that once. Keiko duty. I still remember the names of the victim and family. The Bruno family in Mojave. All of them. Wow, that was 24 years ago. I wonder if we will ever know who and why. On board, 0600. Good morning, folks. This is the captain. This morning we have been attending to some additional duties, and I apologize for being 10 minutes late for pushback, but believe me, we will be early to LAX. This morning it is my sad pleasure to announce that First Lieutenant Jared Landaker, USMC, will be flying with us to his Big Bear home in Southern California. Jared lost his life over the skies of Iraq earlier this month, and today we have the honor of returning him home, along with his mother, father, brother, and uncles. Please join me in making the journey comfortable for the Landaker family and their uniformed escort. Now sit back and enjoy our ride. We are not expecting any turbulence until we reach the Rocky Mountains, and at that time we will do what we can to ensure a smooth ride. For those interested, you can listen in to our progress on Button 9. Up Button 9. Good morning, UA-211. You are cleared to taxi takeoff and cleared to LAX as filed. From the time we started rolling, we never stopped. First Lieutenant Landaker began receiving his due. 4 hours and 35 minutes later, over Big Bear Mountain, the AB-320 makes a left roll and steep bank, and then one to the right. Nice touch, Captain. 5 minutes out from landing, the captain. Ladies and gents, after landing, I'm leaving the fasten seatbelt sign on, and I ask everyone in advance to yield to the Landaker family. Please remain seated until all members have departed the aircraft. Thank you for your patience. We are 20 minutes early. On rollout, I notice red lights, emergency vehicles everywhere. We are being escorted directly to our gate, no waiting anywhere, not even a pause. Out the left window, a dozen Marines in full dress blues. Highway patrol, police, fire crews, all in full dress, with lights on. A true class act by everyone down to a person, from coast to coast. Way to go, United Airlines, for doing the little things right, because they are the big things. Air traffic control for getting the message. To all law enforcement for your display of brotherhood. When the family departed the aircraft, everyone sat silent. Then I heard a lady say, God bless you and your family. Thank you. Then another. then a somber round of applause. The captain read a prepared note from Mrs. Landacre to the effect, "Thank you all for your patience and heartfelt concern for us and our son. We sincerely appreciate the sentiment. It is nice to have Jared home." After departing the aircraft, I found myself, along with 30 others from our flight, looking for a window, not a dry eye in the craft. All of us were bawling like babies. It was one of the most emotional moments of my life. We all stood silent and watched as Jared was taken by his honor guard to an awaiting hearse. Then the motorcade slowly made its way off the ramp. I have finally seen the silent majority. It is deep within us all. Black, brown, white, yellow, red, purple. We are all children, parents, brothers, sisters, etc. We are an American family. What you don't know is that on the flight, I was tapped on the shoulder by Mrs. Landacre, who introduced herself to me after I awoke. Her words were, "I understand you have sons in the service. Please tell them we appreciate their service. We are so proud of our kids who chose to serve at this time. We were so proud of Jared, and today we find ourselves in a fog of disbelief. Jared was 3 days from returning home." Early in our taxi out from the gate at Dulles, the gent next to me, a Fairfax City council member and acquaintance of the Thuot family, and I were talking to the flight attendant and mentioned that we had sons serving on active duty. "What do you say? How tragic? They must be devastated." He said many of the passengers had told him the same thing, so somewhere in the flight he shared his tidbits with Mrs. Landacre. Our flight attendant had been struggling with what to say to find the right words, so he told the Landacre family of passengers who were parents of service members who connected with their grief as parents. After I gathered myself, I stepped back to their row, two behind me, and introduced myself to Mr. Landacre, a veteran of Southeast Asia, as a tanker, and Jared's uncle and brother. What a somber moment. Their Marine captain escort was a first-rate class act. He had been Jared's tactics instructor and volunteered for this assignment. As he said, "Sir, it is the least I could do. He was my friend and a great stick. He absolutely loved to fly. It's an honor to be here on his last flight." 11:15. On my connecting flight, my mind raced. How lucky I was to have had the opportunity to fly my father to Spain and ride the carrier USS John F. Kennedy home in 1981, the same year Jared was born. How lucky I was to have my father on the Crow's Landing when I made my final cat shot in an F-14. Jared's father never had that chance. Jared was at war, 10,000 miles away. When Mr. Landacre and I were talking, he shared with me, when Jared was born, he had no soft spot on his head, and doctors feared he would be developmentally challenged. He became a physics major with honors, a high school and college athlete, and graduated with distinction from Naval Aviation Flight School. He was short in stature, but a Marine all the way. Visit his life story online at www.bigbeargrizzly.net. Bring tissue. February 7, 2007, Anbar Province, Iraq. First Lieutenant Jared Landacre, United States Marine Corps, hero, from Big Bear, California, gave his life in service to his country. Fatally wounded when his CH-46 helicopter was shot down by enemy fire, Jared and his crew all perished. His life was the ultimate sacrifice of a grateful military family and nation. His death occurred at the same time as Anna Nicole Smith, a drug-using person with a seventh-grade education of no pedigree who dominated our news for 2 weeks while Jared became a number on CNN. And, most unfortunately, Jared's death underscores a fact that we are a military at war, not a nation at war. Until we become a nation committed to winning the fight and elect leaders with the spine to ask Americans to sacrifice in order to win, we shall remain committed to being a nation with a military at war and nothing more. And possibly no funding if Congress has their way. First Lieutenant Landacre, a man I came to know in the skies over America on 17 February 2007. From me to you, aviator to aviator, I am unbelievably humbled. It was my high honor to share your last flight. God bless you. Semper Fi.
I have been contemplating on how to put into words what my life has been like since the loss of Jared. What comes to mind are the constant states of loss and survival, coping with the loss of the child, the loss of your identity as their mother, and the loss of knowing how to move forward. The survival state begins at the same time you begin dealing with the realization of your loss. Can I survive my child's death? The constant heartache you carry with you daily? Will your marriage survive the loss? Will our family ever feel peace again? And will we ever find joy and be able to smile when thinking of your loved one? When I became a mother, my life changed for the better in so many ways. I believe I actually knew when I conceived Jared, even though it would not be confirmed for several weeks. His birth was unique for Joe and me, as I gave birth to him at home with Joe delivering him. But on February 7, 2007, with the sound of multiple footsteps and three knocks on our door, life would change again for me, but not for the better. A month prior to this date, a CH-46 had gone down in the Al Anbar province, where Jared was stationed. I emailed him to make sure he was all right. A few hours passed before he responded with the short, "I am fine." But on February 7, 2007, it was a different response. A scroll across the bottom of the TV screen saying a CH-46 had gone down in the same area. I ran to the computer and wrote to Jared to make sure it wasn't him. There was not too much information on the incident, as Anna Nicole Smith had passed that day and she took over the news. By noon, there was still no response, and somewhere deep inside, I knew he would not be coming home. Jared was supposed to come home earlier than his squadron to attend a weapons and tactics course in Yuma, Arizona, to become an instructor. Jared had finished his regular flights at that time and was preparing to return stateside. I recounted his flights and felt sure he was not one of the pilots, only to learn later he had been picked to fly with Captain Jennifer Harris on her last flight before returning to teach at a local college back home. As I waited to hear any news, I thought if I would just hang out in town, they could not find me and inform me my son had been killed. As it turned out, they did find me, and the nightmare began. I had just returned from town and was walking down the hall when I heard the footsteps and knocks. I turned to see two Marines and a Navy chaplain all in uniform, waiting for me to open the door. I hollered to my husband that they were here. He asked who, and I just said, "The Marines." He collapsed on the floor crying and just kept saying, "He was supposed to come home next week." Our lives were changed forever in that instant. It is interesting how your mind helps you survive the loss of this magnitude. I remember bits and pieces of what followed. Bringing Jared home from Dover, following the hearse down the hill, the ceremony and flag presentation, and finally, watching him descend into the earth. The loss of Jared has changed the dynamics of our family in so many ways. There is only the past left when I think of my son. No present, no future. His memory is frozen in my mind, and a constant worry I am going to forget them. There is a sadness that flows over me at times. It is not sadness for myself, for I had the pleasure of being his mom for 25 years. My sadness is for him and all that he will never experience. He will never fall in love, watch her walk down the aisle to become his partner, never see and touch his newborn child for the first time, and so much more. There is always a persistent wondering of what he would look like today. Would he be married? Would he have children, etc.? All the first dates of a child's life that are so special to a parent are now dreaded ones. His birthday and the anniversary of his death are the most difficult. One gave him life, and one took his life. On his birthday, I no longer throw a party and give him a card telling him how much I love him. Now I go to his resting place and post on his legacy board. May 6, 2014. Dear Jer, on your 33rd birthday, I spent it honoring you and a World War II vet in Washington, D.C. I escorted the vet to the World War II Memorial, a place he never thought he would ever get to see in his lifetime. I listened to his stories of war and life afterward, and I shared your life as well. There was a common bond between the both of you that made me so proud of you two, and the sacrifices made for our freedoms. Love and miss you more every day, but especially on your birthday, Mom. Through Jared's loss, I have gained an inner strength I never expected or knew I had. There is a survival instinct deep inside that forces me to get up each day and to look for the joy and peace living offers. I know that is Jared. Laura Landacre.
Chapter 2, A Different Type of After. This project was born from a desire to heighten awareness about the need for services that cater to combat injured service members. Specifically, the need for services that assist in the transition from military to civilian life after a service-related injury. Working with Warrior Foundation Freedom Station was eye-opening from day one, so much so that I made the decision to write a book about this amazing organization that very day. What has transpired between the day I made that decision and now has been one of the most difficult journeys I have ever attempted to write about. I am still unsure if I can adequately articulate the magnitude of loss, strength, sacrifice, inspiration, and wow moments that I have experienced and been able to document in the process of the interviews I conducted. Early on in the process of crafting the foundation for this project, I requested to interview a few of the men who resided at Freedom Station. I never imagined that it would become so all-consuming, emotionally draining, or magnificently inspiring. The interview process was akin to giving pieces of my well-guarded soul away, slowly, and in the most heartbreaking ways possible. It was also an awakening I've never before experienced. I have learned about strength and courage, and, most importantly, sacrifice. Real sacrifice. I have learned what it means to give and to struggle. I have learned what feeling helpless looks like, and I have learned what picking oneself up actually takes. It takes a lot. By a lot, I mean it takes an absolute iron will and a deeply rooted desire to move forward. It takes the stuff that most of us aren't made of. I am lost when I try to come up with an adjective or paint a picture with words of what it takes. Through this book, these stories, and the statistics I uncovered along the way, I hope to paint an accurate and truthful picture of what after looks and feels like for the men and women who survived, as well as what after is like for the loved ones of those who didn't. There are two types of after. There is the after that the families of the fallen live each and every day. I felt that the opening of this book should begin with a story of such an after. I believe every person that I interviewed would agree that it is the fallen and those who mourn them that, at least partially, fuels their drive to move forward and build lives worthy of honoring the ones who did not return home alive. There is another type of after, and that type of after is often lost in the rush to move back to normalcy. The need to somehow put the horror of war behind. This book is for them. This book is for those who assist them. This book is the story of going on after war. But make no mistake, the war will never be over for these men and women. For them, the battle has just begun. Chapter 3, The Statistics. Statistics provide us with data, and data can build solid infrastructure and lay foundations. It can help us see, but it can't help us feel the reality of a lived experience. It can't replace the personal stories that breathe life into the statistics. I have spent a considerable amount of time researching statistics, both on national and local levels. Before we go over some of the data I have uncovered, I want to make it clear what this book is about, and more importantly, what it is not about. This book is not about politics. It isn't about presidents or parties. It wasn't written to push right or left-wing agendas or to justify the actions or inactions of any political party. This book is not about being pro or anti-war, the right to or not to bear arms, oil, or any other issue that I see constantly raised, torn apart, built up, and splashed all over the front pages of media outlets to support specific agendas. The front pages have been littered with conflicting data and interpretations for so long that often Americans no longer understand or remember why we ended up over there. And of course, that statement, in and of itself, is usually cause for debate. There was a time when I was too quick to pick up the sword of words and throw down my best argument for the whys of war, specifically this war. But that all changed when I was given a unique position to study the aftermath firsthand. My perception changed drastically. I came to understand that there is a much bigger picture, a human picture, that is more often than not lost on those of us who were not directly affected by the human tragedies of war. Our most important resource, those who volunteer to serve in our military, should be our first and biggest priority. Those that come home wounded should never have to wonder or worry about how they are going to put the pieces back together. They should not be alone in that process. The number of service members killed in action from 2001 through July 2015.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.